Hey everybody, it's Kevin Tim, and I'm going to show you how to manage your media and defensive resolve and stuff. This is probably one of the most underutilized tools in DaVinci Resolve. Whether you're sending something to a remote colorist, VFX artist, or just an editor, or you're using this for your own personal archive or project management, this hidden tool can revolutionize a lot of people's workflows. And really quick before we jump in, this intrusive notification wants to tell you something, but just ignore it because it's not important. So when we jump into Resolve, we can go right up to File and Media Management. And this is the tool that we're going to look at for the duration of today. And right away, the first two things that we're going to look at are copy and transcode. And copy is going to copy the original source footage, similar to how you would remux footage through OBS or FFmpeg or a similar tool. It copies the original source codec and doesn't do any sort of conversion or transcoding. It actually keeps the integrity of the original source media, whether it's H.264, 5, ProRes, DNxHR, RAW, you get the gist. And transcode does what you would expect. It converts the file into whatever format you specify here. Similar to how you would in the deliver page, except we have a little bit different types of control here than we do on the deliver page. And then up top, we can either choose to do the entirety of the project. This means it'll take every single clip that you have in your media pool and run it through this process. We could do timelines, which looks at specific timelines that we want to run either through copying or transcoding. And then we have clips, which means we can either select certain clips in our media pool or certain clips in our timeline. Now, first off, we're going to look at the entire project tab, and we're going to look at our media management settings that we have here and take a look at what each of them do. We'll be looking at some timeline stuff as well. But if we look right away at copy or transcode in whichever tab you're using, you can either choose to copy all media, which will copy every single thing in your entirety of the project. You can use media, which means it's only taking what clips are used in timelines. And then we have use media and trim keeping such and such frame handles. And this means similar to use media, it's only taking what's in a timeline, but it's only using the portions of clips that are actually being utilized in any timeline, plus any additional frame handles at the beginning and ending of each clip. So if we added 24 frame handles, that means it's going to say, I'm adding 24 frames to the beginning and 24 frames to the ending of whatever media it is using. And the only stipulation with this is if you have multiple clips in your timeline, and I'm going to showcase this really quick. I'm going to go ahead and open up this one. Let's say I had this clip, but I only wanted to use segments of it. I can cut out the beginning, cut out the end, and maybe I'm actually going to cut out this middle part here. So I'm going to remove these clips here of the same clip. Remember, these are part of the same source. So I'm going to go head back into the media management pool, tab, button. Have I ever told you how I hate naming conventions? Just kidding. I like them. It's just that I don't, but you know, I do. You get it. If I go into my timelines tab after cutting those out, I can select that timeline it's in. And now there's another thing I want to point out here too. If we look at our current size and new size, this will show the current size of all the media that it's looking at and what the size will be after it runs through its process. So in this case, we wouldn't be changing anything because we're copying the same stuff and we're not trimming any of it. So it's the exact same size. But if we went over to transcode and did the same thing and converted it to a different format, you can see that we have a different size. So it gives us our estimated size that the clips are going to be after they run through the conversion. It's a really useful tool you don't really get anywhere else, where it tells you the specific file size it's going to end up with. But we're going to go back to copy for now. I'm going to switch that. And the first thing I want to demonstrate is this use media and trim. And with this selected, without this consolidate option selected, this will make multiple instances of this one clip. Even though they're the same source, it's going to create multiple clips because there's a gap in between the first instance and the second instance. So if I showcase this really quick, I'm going to go ahead and hit start. You'll see that it's creating three different clips here. And if we go into the files that it made, you can see that these are the same original source clip, but it made a new instance and has a different naming convention here. So for every instance of this original clip that it sees, it'll make a new clip that has some sort of naming convention here. And these naming conventions can change depending on the type of footage that you have, whether it's DPX or Red Raw or QuickTime files, they all have slightly different variances, but the core functionality will be the same and it'll operate the same regardless. So I'm going to go ahead and just back out of here, and I'm going to delete this one for now so we don't get confused. And let's say I go back into the Media Management tab and we do the same thing, except now I'm going to select this consolidate multiple edit segments into one file. And watch what happens to the new size when I do that. It increases. And that's because what it's doing now is looking at the earliest frame of the file that is being used in any timeline, or at least in the timelines that we specify, and the last frame that it sees. And then it's just going to make a trimmed copy of that clip just from beginning to end, and it'll only make one instance of it. So even though we have two cuts here in the timeline, if I start, you can see it's only making two files. And then if we go into the finished product, we see that is just one clip. It's just a trimmed version of the original source. Go ahead and delete it again. And because we use the copy parameter, it's still the original quality of that file. If we use transcode, it would be a different story. So now let's look at a couple of these other parameters. I'm going to uncheck this for now. If we see use project name subfolder, you'll notice that when we were making those folders in here, it was keeping the name of the project file in it. But if I just export without this toggle turned on, this use project name subfolder turned on, and I go ahead, I'm going to specify the timeline. This is still unchecked. I'm going to go ahead and hit start. Now it's just going to put everything here by itself. And anytime you do a timeline export from the media management tool, it'll automatically make a DRT file, which is this right here. It does not create a DRT if you use the entire project or clips tab. So really quick, we're going to look at the preserve hierarchy after however many folder levels. This essentially means that if you have a specific folder structure that you're using, you can choose to keep that folder structure when you make your copies or transcodes. So as you can see here, I have a specific folder structure that I use. So I can go into sources, video, camera, bingo machine, and that's where these source clips are located. So if I preserve up to zero, two things can happen if you set it to zero. One, it's either going to use the volume level or the hard drive name for your folder, and then everything after that, or it will fail and or it won't be able to create them at all. In this case, it won't be able to use it. So I have to go one folder level in and it'll use everything from this point on. So basically that's where my folder structure typically starts. So you usually don't really have a reason to keep the name in there, but it is an option if you want it. So if I keep one folder level here, that means it's going to keep everything from here on. So if I make that and then go into my other window here, you can see that we have our folders here with everything that it sees clips in. So I'm going to delete these and make sure it's not too confusing. If I go ahead and go to Media Management again, and if I set this to 3, we can go back and look and see that means it's going to go 1, 2, 3 folders in. So it's going to land on video, and then it'll include video, camera, and bingo machine. So I'm going to go ahead and do that to show it. Not the whole thing. I did that wrong. That would take too long. I don't have that kind of time. I'm going to select the timeline. There, now we got 3. Okay, this is easier. Hit start. And now we can see there it includes just video, camera, bingo machine. Boom, there's our clips. Delete these again. Delete! And then we have this relink to new files button. So if I go to timeline, it's like BB rolls. And relink new files, what this will do is it'll change where the media in your project or timeline is linked to the new clips that you just created. So as an example, if I relink to new files here, hit start, it creates those clips. And now if I go into my media pool and I right click this and open file location, it actually links it to what we just generated now. But let me go ahead and delete these, and you can see it takes them offline because now it can't find them. I'll just relink it to where they were, so I can showcase this. If I go to Media Management again and don't check relink to new files, I do the same thing. You can see that when I find a media pool and open file location, it still links to the original source. So this option can be useful if you're sending stuff to a different hard drive and you want to be able to automatically relink stuff for whoever you're sending it to. Or if you're just transferring all your footage onto a new drive and you don't want to have to go through the pain of relinking everything all over again. And then the last thing we're going to look at is just the difference in the selected media pool and selected timeline clips. If I select these two clips in the media pool here, I go to Media Management, I can see that if I select Media Pool Clips, here's where it shows the size. And if I do the Use Media, it's still looking at all of the timelines to determine how much of the clip has been used. So we can still do our same processes as before. And if I go to Selected Timeline Clips, I have to select the clips in the timeline first. Go to Media Management. The same thing is true. If I want to use the entirety of those clips, if I want to trim them, or if I just want to use all of the media that's located in that timeline. Now, I will say sometimes this relink to new files does get grayed out for whatever reason, and it usually happens when you hit Selected Timeline Clips on the Clips tab, and then all of a sudden it's gone for both of your timeline options as well. But if you go back to Entire Project and then just switch whatever media you're using, then for some reason it can pop back online. I don't exactly know what the bug is here, but this is just something to note if you're trying to use that toggle. Who knows, in a future version, this might not be an issue. At the time of recording this, even the manual is not completely in line with how it works right now. This tool has a ton of use cases, and I would love to see something that this helped you with in the comments, or if you have any more questions about Resolve, leave a comment on that as well. And if you just want to leave a comment for the sake of leaving a comment, leave a comment. And if you want to learn about proxy footage for when you're sending stuff to a remote editor, or you just want playback to run smoother yourself, look at this video, because that's where I talk about it. You'll be an expert with the difference between intraframe and intraframe codecs. Just watch it, please. This is Camera Tim, signing out. I gotta manage my time better. Aha! Uh-huh!